I'm Brian Mayu from the Environmental Science Department, and I'd like to get us started for today. So I want to just welcome everyone to our 35th anniversary celebration. We've been thinking about this for a while, and we're just really, truly excited to have everyone back. And seeing so many people come back, it's pretty amazing. When we were first thinking of this, we didn't know how it was going to go. But we knew we really wanted to get as many of our alums back as we could, because that really, like, and I can already say, just seeing you all here, that just keeps us thinking about how we can keep improving, working to help you all in the future. And when we started to think about this celebration, it was over a year ago, so we didn't know it would be such a time of change, right? If you think about it, we really need well-trained environmental scientists now more than ever. And in addition, our department's undergoing change. Stephanie Furman, she's going to leave at the end of the academic year to spearhead new efforts at Arizona State. And Peter Bauer is also going to be retiring in 2 years. And when you think about our department, you think about those two. And so for us, it's just a huge time of change. I can't imagine the department, you know, going into our little corner past the table and not having the two of them there, right? So I don't even know what we're going to do. We're going to have to even, like, maybe I'll get to change some of Peter's pictures from 35 years ago. I guess that's a good change. Or I'll leave a couple up for him. But we really need to think about, you know, where has the department been and where is it going? And we want to build on this legacy. And so what happened was, as we were thinking about today, as scientists, you know, we know how to do research. I can get a student into the lab and get them doing things. We can write grants. You know, we can submit papers. But outside of academics, we know a lot less, right? And when I, even like over lunch when I was hearing you all talk, like, we know a lot less. And so we wanted to bring many alum back, and we were trying to bring alum back that had a really broad range and diversity of experiences. And this way we could learn from you. And so we're hoping is that, like, over the course of today, we'll get lots of input and ideas from you, and it'll help shape where we're going for the next 35 years. So welcome to our event. Make sure you bring your ideas and your enthusiasm, and that we're going to have, you know, lots of students coming in throughout the day. We have a ton of people from everywhere today. So we just really look forward to connecting and talking and learning from everyone. So now, to sort of get the program going, I want to introduce Samantha Katz, O1, who's done a lot of amazing things, and she's been a community builder, connector, entrepreneur, etc. So she's going to come up and get us going. Thank you.
Hi. Call and response. Hi. You awake? We all just had some lunch. I was thinking about what to talk about today, since I only get a few minutes at the microphone, and as we think through environmental leadership and the importance of today, there are some things I started to reminisce over, and it's really an expression of gratitude is how I'd like to welcome and start today. It starts with gratitude to not just Barnard, but to Stephanie in particular, and the Environmental Science Department, in terms of giving me the opportunity to explore, nurturing my growth and development within the 4 years within these walls, and also giving me the opportunity to explore and engage my curiosities beyond these walls while I was a student. And in retrospect, in thinking about this, I know everybody has on their papers, it says, you know, Barnard Class of 01, Environmental Policy. So I came to Stephanie very early on, my freshman year. I had come to Barnard thinking that I was going to be an environmental engineer and that I was going to be on the five-year path here. And very quickly, in Peter Bauer's environmental science class, Intro to Environmental Science, I learned that maybe I wasn't here to be in a lab or out in the field, but that there was some other useful place for my skill set. And I had to figure out how to nurture that, and I was also thinking about the future of what could you do with environmental leadership. And I came to Stephanie very early on, and I said, I have this idea, creating an environmental science policy degree for, for Barnard, what do you think? And she very kindly sponsored me through that path, which was not easy as it got rejected my sophomore year. But it's here today for everyone to have, which is amazing. And it's truly a thankful, I thank you, Stephanie, for giving me that opportunity. So how did it shape my future in terms of environmental leadership? Well, it comes in a couple of ways. My global land use and habitability class with Cynthia Rosenzweig my sophomore year led to a moment that I always reflect upon, which is how important it is to network within your class, within a room. So look around today. There are about 150 to 200 of us here. If you can somehow figure out how to meet half of the people in the room and create a meaningful connection, you've done a good job. Please use LinkedIn, because it's important to maintain those connections, because you never know where everybody in this room is going to be next and how important they are, but they're obviously here because they're committed to this discussion. So in that room with Cynthia Rosenzweig, my sophomore year, I ended up meeting a student in my class who happened to be doing something that I was really excited about, and this was pre-Google. So I had read a section of an environmental economics book in a class being taught by Jeffrey Sachs, and it had three pages on the idea of environmental markets, specifically air pollution markets. And I thought, if we truly want people to care about the environment, we're going to have to associate a real value to it. And so I met a student in Cynthia Rosenzweig's class who actually was working on one of the two trading floors on Wall Street at the time that was brokering environmental commodities. So lucky. Had I not been in that class at the right time, I would not have met that person. I ended up with a seat, his seat, on that trading floor, and it launched a 15-year career building environmental markets. Things that you read about today in the New York Times, or used to read about prior to this year, in the New York Times, things like climate change, renewable energy, investing in impact. I was one of 10 people at the beginning of those discussions of language, nomenclature, how to draft the regulations, how to perfect the regulations, how do we truly assign value, and I'm one of those few people in the world that did that. And about 3.5 years ago, I decided to exit Wall Street and take a step back and think about what does it mean to be an activist in environmentalism. And along the way, I've helped Barnard in terms of that gratitude and expressing that gratitude. I've sat on the advisory board to the Endowment on Sustainability and Socially Responsible Investing. I've sponsored courses here on environmental leadership. And so when I think about how to give back to the people and the system that nurtured my growth, my intellectual curiosity, this is how I do it. And today, I'm every day that I read the paper and every moment that I hear of a natural disaster, which is probably somehow related to climate change, or I hear of poisoning of people in Flint, Michigan, I think, how can I take what I have done in terms of environmental leadership and put it into action? And so here we are. Stephanie has brought us together to figure out how to take our environmental leadership and put it into action, and is once again coming into my life to nurture and grow my intellectual curiosity by bringing back alum who are immersed in this in their daily lives, by bringing students into this conversation, by bringing the teachers into this conversation, because I truly believe that if we can channel our energy, harness our collective power, and bridge the gaps in communication, no matter how daunting the future look, that we can be the new future. We can build the new infrastructure. We can design the world we want to live in. We can be the change we want in the world. And so if there's anything for me today, I will be listening just as much as you hear me talking about how important it is to move from talk to action. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Samantha. We really appreciate this. And as a department, we've been working really hard on this event, and we're really excited about the way that we've structured this. So our first panel will be called Policy Matters. And what we'll be doing in this panel is we'll be looking for what are the challenges and opportunities that we have to both shape and implement policy, especially during the times that we're facing right now, but also thinking longer term over the coming decades, at least 35 years into the future. Another thing, Brian had mentioned a couple of the personnel changes in the department. We also have another academic change, which is just yesterday in this room, the environmental policy major was voted to be changed to environment and sustainability. And so with that, we have some changes, right? With that, we have some changes, and so what we'll be looking for from this panel is to be looking to see how we can prepare students with the future in mind. And so what I'd like to do is ask all the panelists to come up here and we'll take their seats. And then I'll just say one sentence about each of them and then they will give their presentations. So as they're coming up, I can introduce them. So the first speaker will be Commissioner Trautenberg, Polly Trautenberg. She actually majored in history, but we don't hold that against her because the environmental science major had just been established. And also because she's doing such tremendous work to make New York more sustainable in terms of transportation. Our second speaker will be Diane Pataki. And Diane received in 2008 the highest medal that is given in our field for an early career scientist. It was the McIlwainy Medal. And I actually met her at the National Science Foundation where she too was working on shaping environmental research and education as a program manager there. Hadiah Finman is listed in your program. She's from EPA, and unfortunately, she couldn't make it here today because some things came up at EPA that she had to deal with. You can understand that, potentially. Our next speaker will be Jessica Bolson, and Jessica is working on a wide range of issues. One of the things that she did was she crafted a Florida statewide agenda for climate change and water resource management. And just the other day, I was at a conference, and somebody was talking about someone who did this terrific thesis where they were managing to actually connect different sectors together, and it turned out it was Jessica's PhD thesis they were referring to. And our fourth speaker will be Jamie Consuega. Still an undergraduate here, she co-authored her thesis research in Nature, which is the premier science journal in our field. And it came out in January 2006, even before she graduated. So with this, I'd like to ask everybody to welcome all the panelists. And we'll start with Commissioner Trautenberg. Let me just pull up your slides.
All right, thank you so much, Professor Furman. Or I guess everyone's just calling you Stephanie. Barnard's
yes.
Grown more informal since the time that I was here. And I'm sad to arrive on a day, I guess it's just been announced that you're going to Arizona. I know that will be a big loss here because I've heard such wonderful things about you. Thank you for inviting me here today with distinguished faculty and alumni and students. And as you pointed out, I was a history major. I had a short scientific career at Barnard. It was one chemistry class. I barely passed it, and I was on to the social sciences. But I wanted to call out a few of my fellow Barnard alums. First of all, Catherine Cook, who has worked in the environmental department for many, many years. And she's been at Barnard for almost 30 years. We were old classmates. And then two fellow alums who you should be very proud of, her work at New York City DOT, Kidari Reddy at the Office of, it's a weird name for this office, it's long and complicated, the Office of Environmental Compliance Assessment, but really she's the person who oversees so much of the work that we do, the environmental impact that our agency has, air, water, et cetera, and I know you'll hear from her. And then Hannah Roth, who serves in our general counsel's office, who handles actually a whole variety of matters, but both of them have had tremendously distinguished careers, and so I'm not surprised that they are Barnard women. Now, as Stephanie said, I was a history major, and my career sort of became one that was much more on the public policy side of the house, not so much the scientific side. I was for many years a staffer on Capitol Hill, did a lot of work on transportation and environment, and then was at the United States Department of Transportation in the Obama administration, ran the policy office there, and then had the good fortune to become New York City DOT commissioner. And I've always loved transportation, but I've always viewed it through the lens of sustainability, how we make cities function better, how we make them greener. And, you know, so today I'm going to talk just a little bit about some of the things that we're doing in the de Blasio administration. I think Stephanie alluded to it a little bit. this is such a crucial time in the world for environmental science, and I look around the room and I see all the, you know, the amazing students who will be stepping into this field. It's no secret that I think from where we sit, so much of the important environmental gains of this country right now are under assault. Climate policy, air, water, public lands, you name it. A lot of bad things coming out of Washington, and I was in Washington for many years, so I can say that with some assurity. So I'm proud to say at the urban level, at the city level, as you all probably know, a lot of mayors are stepping up. And even as the country is retreating from the Paris Accords, New York City and a bunch of other cities and some states, New York State and other states, have pledged that they're going to do their part to continue to try and meet those carbon emission reduction goals. So I'm going to talk just briefly about some of the things we're doing at the New York City DOT level. And just to give you all a little bit of the sense of the scope of our agency, we are about $2.5 billion a year, 5,500 person agency. We own, maintain, and operate many of the roads and the bridges, the bike lanes, the Staten Island Ferry. We are not the people who run the subways, but we work in conjunction with that agency, the MTA, on trying to improve bus service. So we have a very big environmental footprint, and our agency actually controls almost a quarter of the landmass of New York City. So, and you'll hear from some of my colleagues about some of the impacts of what we do. So let's see if I can get this to work. Oh, there we go. So a few big documents, if you all are interested in what's happening at the urban level on climate change, I recommend you take a look at these. Some big pledges made by the city and Mayor de Blasio to make New York City a leader in climate change, to reduce really ambitious goal by 2050 greenhouse gas emissions by 80%. And to get there, I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the things we're going to be doing. And first of all, hopefully you can see this slide. New York City is a bit unusual if you compare it to other American cities. In most other American cities, the transportation sector is the biggest driver of greenhouse gas emissions. Because New York, we are already such a walking and transit-dependent city, we actually, transportation only represents about 22% of carbon emissions. Actually, in this city, it's much more about buildings. But that said, if we're going to reach an ambitious goal, you know, as 80 by 50, we're going to have to reduce emissions in transportation as well. And it's interesting, if you can see this, as much as we are one of the most efficient cities in the U.S., compared to some of our European and Asian counterparts, we still are emitting carbon at a higher rate. So there's clearly more that can be done. And just I'm just going to talk quickly about sort of a couple of tranches and plant a seed for some of you who are in the environmental field. So in my time working on the policy side of transportation, there's always kind of two buckets of things that people look at in terms of sustainability, reducing carbon, preserving wetlands, air, water, you name it. One is what we would sort of talk of as mode shifting, which is encouraging people to get out of the mode that emits the most carbon and has the most environmental impact, which is single occupancy vehicles, to encourage them to take mass transit, to walk, to bike, to look at ways that now, particularly in this technological age, we can make those systems work better, we can make them more appealing to the younger generation, we can use pricing and data to try and improve how they operate and have people make better economic choices. So we are trying to do that in the management of our roadways, we're working with the MTA to try and do that with the subways, and we'll be looking in the future for other ways that we can better manage demand. I've often found in my years on Capitol Hill that sort of, and I know some of the folks who are going to be speaking today come from the various environmental groups, and one thing I've seen just in my time is the environmental groups often focus on what I'm going to kind of talk to next, which is the technological and fuel side, and less on the mode shifting and demand side. And I would just urge all of you who are going into this field to have an interest in transportation to think about both, because I think both pieces of the puzzle are so essential. But we are looking on the technological side, and particularly I'd say the big challenge this city is facing is how we better adopt electric vehicles. We've been slowly electrifying the city fleet, but as you all probably know, there's some real complications in getting the type of vehicles you need, and as we're looking now to put charging stations on the streets, they draw an enormous amount of electrical power. So there's some real practical considerations there, but clearly if we're going to achieve 80 by 50, we're going to have to get to a place where we're close to zero emissions in terms of our vehicles. So that's just a flavor of some of the things we're working on, and I really look forward to hearing the questions of what I know is going to be a very great group of students, so thank you.
So we'll go to Diane now.
Well, thank you so much. This is fantastic to be back here. It's just really awesome to be back. I think right here in this room, I remember doing freshman orientation around 1990, so wow, here we are. A lot has happened in the department, a lot's happened in New York City, and a lot's happened in the world since then. And I'm going to show you a few slides that I've actually been toting around for a while. So I'm a professor, and I've actually been called upon to tell the story of how I became interested in the research topic that I eventually selected. And so I've actually been carrying around this picture of Peter Bauer for many, many years. And it's a pretty old picture. And he looks exactly the same. There he is, back when I was a student here. And when I tell this story, I tell the story to students, often to undergraduates, and they get a little freaked out because it turns out that I'm still kind of studying the topic that I selected for my senior thesis. And the students get really scared because then they're afraid to pick a thesis topic. They're like, am I going to be stuck studying this thing for 25 years if I pick this topic? But the answer is yes and no. Science, like life, has all these twists and turns. And so in just like 7 minutes, I want to tell you a little bit about how I started out with this thesis topic here at Barnard, and I went on this journey that has taken me into a place that I never would have imagined, but it's a very interesting place. So back in about 1991 or 1992, this video came out called The Greening of Planet Earth. And I looked, you can watch it on YouTube today. There have been sequels since then, but it was hot off the presses when Peter showed it to us in one of the many, many classes I took with him here. And this video really interested me. So this video was making an argument that climate change was gonna be great because all this extra carbon dioxide that was being pumped into the atmosphere was gonna make plants grow faster, and it would be awesome because we'd have more food, the forests would be growing, we'd have timber, and yay, greenhouse gases. So, you know, Peter said, take a look at this video, you might wanna think about this kind of critically. And it was put out by the coal industry, by the way. And I really found this topic quite interesting. So I started to dig into this a little bit deeper. So basically, the way this works is, here's the very famous curve of CO2 concentrations rising in the atmosphere since these measurements started in the late 1950s, very careful measurements, and the CO2 concentrations continually go up. It's amazing to look at this graph. When I was here in the early 1990s, the global CO2 concentration was only 350 parts per million, and now it's over 400, so that's really weird to think about. But in addition to that, we know how much CO2 should be in the atmosphere based on fossil fuel combustion. We know how much fossil fuels we've burned. And actually, the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere should look like that top line. So there's a gap between the CO2 that should be in the atmosphere and what is in the atmosphere. And it turns out that that was a missing sink of carbon in the 1990s. And I ran out of classes to take with Peter at some point, but I needed to take more to fulfill my major requirements. So I headed across the street and took a class with this guy, Wally Broker, one of the most famous geochemists in the world. And he was studying this question too, coincidentally. And he taught us that the oceans could only be taking up half the missing carbon. And he was sure about that because of this conveyor belt of ocean water that travels around the world. That's a limiting factor in how much CO2 the oceans can absorb. He's like, look, the oceans are taking up half the carbon, the other half, it's got to be in the terrestrial biosphere. So plant biologists, they're just missing the boat. They don't know what's going on. They need to find this carbon. I was like, wow, that's really interesting. I'm going to take plant biology. So I took a class here at Barnard with Helen Young, who I believe is now at Princeton, botany class. And she taught us the details of this, how this thing actually works. Yes, plants could be taking up extra carbon, but a lot more work needed to be done. So this was my thesis topic. It was called The Role of the Terrestrial Biosphere in the Global Carbon Cycle, I think. And so I had to type it on a typewriter, so I don't have it anymore. But I think it was called that. And in doing the research for that thesis, I learned that Duke University was going to build a big experiment to test this. And what they did was they built this thing that I eventually saw under construction. I left Barnard, and I went to Duke to get a PhD so I could work on this. They built this big experiment in the forest, and they put all these pipes up in the forest, and they started blowing extra CO2 onto this semi-natural forest to see if it would grow faster. So I studied that for a really long time. And I mean a long time. My PhD, I did a postdoc, I did another postdoc. And I ended up working for an organization called the International Geosphere Biosphere Program, and we synthesized all the data that existed on this. So this is from a book that we published, I guess, in 2007-ish, where we looked at all this experimental data. And I can say now, with certainty, that the greening of planet Earth is wrong. So, but it took me a really long time to answer that. And if you look at the data, first of all, the response of plants to CO2 saturates. So right about now, just over about 400 ppm, the response function just saturates for physiological reasons. So this extra subsidy we've been getting from plant growth is not going to last into the future. So it is not going to save us from increased greenhouse gases. Secondly, about half of these missing carbon sink, which is no longer missing, is not due to this. It's due to land use change. It's due to the fact that forests have grown back, particularly here in the eastern U.S. After the Civil War, this area, which had been all agriculture, grew back into forests, sucked up a lot of CO2. Now those forests are being removed for urban growth. So that sink's not going to last either. So we have a big policy issue here. A lot of people are worried about how to facilitate the regrowth of tropical forests and avoid further deforestation in the tropics. But I became interested in a different thing, because I'm a New Yorker, I'm from here, I went to school here, and I started to be interested in all these tree planting programs that cities were doing, like New York City, which has a 1 million tree planting program. And LA has one as well. I've worked on the one in Los Angeles quite a bit. So one of the reasons that you'll hear why cities want to plant trees is to pull more CO2 out of the atmosphere, but unfortunately, that doesn't work scientifically. You'll still hear the city talking about this today, but it's impossible thermodynamically for urban plants to offset that CO2 appreciably, because the city emits orders of magnitude more CO2 than urban trees can offset. So I got really interested in this link between science and policy in cities. Now, the first response of scientists to issues like this is to say, well, policymakers, they don't understand science. Like, we have to just communicate science better. But as I started working on cities, I realized I didn't really know anything about cities. I needed to be educated better, too. I mean, I know how trees work. So if I'm trying to help design a solution for cities that involves green space and trees, I need to learn a little bit more about things like urban planning and urban design. And so I delved more into the process of how science works, how urban planning works, how urban design works, and the details of this diagram are not important, but these different disciplines have a separate process, and they're linked, but the link is usually really slow. So to deliver scientific information, we wait for urban planners to read our papers like 20 years later, right? It's like, we don't have that kind of time. Same thing with scientists. We try and figure out what urban planners did to plan the city, but we don't talk to them very directly, so that's really slow. So basically, what I do now is work on this new field called ecological planning and design, and it tries to align the processes together so that scientists, planners, and designers work on the same team to come up with the problem that we want to solve, to come up with the methods that we want to solve it, and to study these projects like experiments. So as a scientist, I help design these design projects, but I also then monitor the results. And in that case, the results of these scientific studies will be incorporated into the next design project much more quickly than just sitting around waiting for someone to read a peer-reviewed paper. Finally, this is my email address. I have hired graduates from Barnard, people who wanted to come to Salt Lake City, Utah, which is where I am. It turns out that's not a lot of people, but I love it there. So if for some reason you do want to come out to Salt Lake City, let me know. Thanks.
Thanks so much, Diane. And our next speaker will be Jessica. And here are your slides.
Okay. Hello, Barnard. It's so great to be back. Thank you, Stephanie, and other members of the Environmental Science Department faculty and staff for organizing this event. Things look a little different around here, but the general feel is the same, so that's nice. I'm a research scientist at Florida International University at the Southeast Environmental Research Center there. For those of you who don't know, FIU is a very large, minority-serving state university located right in the center of Miami. And the Southeast Environmental Research Center there has a long history of working with stakeholders in the region on water, ecology, and mostly Everglades issues. So my role within the center is as a social scientist working on interdisciplinary teams who like to study these sort of large, complex socio-ecological or socio-environmental challenges. And more specifically, I'm really interested in the sort of translation of scientific information, namely climate science information, forecasts, and long-term projections into decision-making in the water sector. So more broadly, though, I consider myself an interdisciplinarian. And so I thought today that it would be useful to share sort of my research path and how I got to where I am today and the lessons I've learned and I'm still learning. Okay, so thinking back, you know, what really stands out for me is research exposure. So being exposed to lots of different types of research, it's sort of nice to follow Diane because, you know, she started from one path that sort of stayed similar, but me, I was all over the place. So that's kind of a common theme in my life, I guess. But anyway, so I started, my first real research experience was here at Barnard. I did a study on Siberian peat cores with Dorothy Petit at Lamont. We looked at macrofossils in those peat cores to try to retrace the plant history of the area. And then after school, I traveled around South America with another environmental science alum who's in the room, and then came back ultimately to New York to teach high school biology and physics at Washington Irving High School. I taught for 5 years there, and while there, I also pursued a master's at NYU in biology education. I conducted research for that too, although it was on student outcomes, and we did this really great project where we had to, it was called Action Research in Education, and we had to envision ourselves as our students. So we basically followed a student around for an entire day. And then, you know, that was meant to give us a better perspective on what they experience and, you know, try to connect with their students. And it's still to this day, I think about that experience because it made me a better teacher. And also as a teacher, I was selected to do this Teacher at Sea program at University of Washington, which put me out in the middle of the Pacific looking at hydrothermal vents with this ROV Jason Explorer, which was super cool. And I was just thrilled at like learning a new science and understanding that I never really realized that scientists who did this kind of work actually built their own tools. And you know, they were using things like forks to sort of improvise when we were out there. And it was just, that was wild to me. So ultimately I came back to New York and decided I wanted to pursue my graduate studies. I met with a lot of people, some of them in this room, to talk about, you know, what exactly I should study, because although the science was really exciting for me, I felt like there was something missing in the connection to society. So ultimately, I found out about this new Climate Society program at Columbia, and I enrolled in that program. I was a part of the first class, and that was just it for me. I loved that program. The study of, you know, where climate and society meet in terms of how decisions that are made can sort of impact vulnerabilities was really fascinating for me. I worked at the IRI on a project looking at locusts, so you can see the diversity in my research experience. But ultimately, through that project, or through that program, I connected with Kenny Broad, who invited me to University of Miami to pursue a PhD. So I moved to Miami and pursued my PhD in ecosystem science and policy. And my research there focused on integrating climate information into water resource management in South Florida. For this research, I worked with an interdisciplinary team of scientists who were my committee that had its own set of challenges trying to sort of communicate with an anthropologist, engineers, you know, an agricultural specialist, a hydrologist, an economist. That was my committee. But ultimately, it was fascinating because I got to see all different aspects of this water problem that we were trying to tackle. I also worked very closely with stakeholders in the region. So I liked this sort of aspect of being separated from, while I was still totally immersed in the university world, I was kind of separated and working on a real practical problem. So that was exciting for me. I also worked at the Department of Environmental Protection, as Stephanie mentioned, while I was doing my PhD, and also did a couple consulting positions, like at Risk Management Solutions. So I was able to get a good amount of experience in different areas, which helped me really to sort of formulate my research interest and pursue that. I did a postdoc at the Decision Risk Management and Decision Processing Center at Wharton, where we were looking at another sort of aspect of South Florida water and climate, and then spent a little bit of time at Miami Waterkeeper as the director of climate and freshwater program when this opportunity came up to work on this project, which I'm working on now, which is called the Urban Water Innovation Network. And this is what I'm mostly focused on at FIU now. I guess I have two sort of main areas of research there. One is I'm looking at homeowner adoption of water technologies, because our sort of the UN approach is to try to develop and understand the transition to sustainable water management across 6 case study cities in the United States. And you know, my thinking is kind of linked to what you said, something that you said, that we can't really get anywhere until we understand what type of factors influence the adoption of these technologies. So we're looking at homeowner scale adoption of these technologies across our case study sites. I also co-direct the stakeholder outreach and engagement for this project. So that has me traveling across the country to work with stakeholders in each of our regions. It's Miami, LA, Denver, the Sun Corridor, so I might see you in Arizona, Portland, nice places to visit, and Baltimore. So basically we're trying to understand the major challenges facing stakeholders who are trying to transition their urban systems to more sustainable approaches, and it's a challenge. It's really interesting, but it is a challenge. So I thought I would talk a little bit more about conducting interdisciplinary research in the university setting. I know we are hearing different perspectives from this panel, but I want to focus specifically on conducting this research like I do at a center in a university. So again, the good is it's complex and challenging. This is part of why I love it so much. There's sort of a never-ending list of really interesting research questions that are, you know, really relevant to society today. And we get to engage with diverse stakeholders. So, you know, we're constantly meeting with people who are actually sort of, you know, in the trenches working on trying to solve these issues, which I really enjoy. It's been really helpful for me to be the social scientist on these interdisciplinary projects, I think, in attracting funds. You know, sometimes I get called and sort of as the add-on to projects as a social scientist, because National Science Foundation and NOAA, two groups that we work with a lot in getting funding, they require or they ask for these projects to be interdisciplinary, and a lot of times people don't know a social scientist to call, so they last minute call me up and say, hey, do you want to work on this project? That's not my ideal way to work on a project, but that happens. And then I can kind of convince them of all the merits of social science in these projects afterwards. But anyway, it's been sort of promising in terms of getting these funds. And it also uses different skills and the skill set that I developed in graduate school, being mostly sciences. It asks me to sort of communicate with different folks, and I enjoy that. The bad is that it's complex and challenging. So sometimes, like for example, I was at a meeting last week on trying to find solutions to put reclaimed water in Miami. And there's just, you know, we've looked at this problem from multiple different perspectives and we can't find a place to put water. And so that, looking at sea level rise in Miami, is very challenging. Sometimes I leave feeling very overwhelmed. So that's tough. And then there's this varied commitment across the research community. So, and to this I mean to conducting interdisciplinary work. So when it gets tough and we're having a hard time finding approaches that sort of, you know, we can all agree on, I think people retreat back to their silos a little bit. And so it's sort of hard to work in that context. Institutional constraints, such as departments sort of haven't caught up with necessarily the drive to pursue interdisciplinary research, and it's hard to know how well we're doing. So these are sort of these barriers and bridges I included here to sort of encourage us to think about how to overcome some of the challenges to conducting interdisciplinary research. And part of that is because I really think this is where the in terms of academic research, this is where we're going to find a lot of our answers to the questions that are troubling society. So I really think it's important to sort of pursue these approaches. Again, in the university setting, there are these sort of traditional academic institutions and reward systems like, you know, promotions and tenure track hiring that still tend to fall along these disciplinary lines. I know Stephanie's published on this. There's a lot of literature on this out there if you're interested in learning more. It's hard to communicate across disciplines, and we're not necessarily trained in this in our PhD or graduate programs. And we're often left feeling, you know, uncomfortable. I feel like I'm sort of the fish out of water a lot in my work. So what's helped in sort of helping me overcome this is finding the right program and people to work with. And I will second what Samantha said. Some of the folks I work most closely with, I can sort of trace the connections back all the way to Barnard and all the way. One person who's on my grant right now is somebody that I worked with in my first lab at experience with Dorothy Petit. So those connections are really important. And you know, nurturing those relationships is critical to, I think, moving forward. And then focus on people skills. So if you don't find the right program in your sort of academic setting, then look elsewhere. I've done a lot of training programs that have helped me to be a better communicator, which largely means being a better listener. And then, you know, sort of own it. Feel brave. And I felt like I needed to include this because in thinking about today and coming back to Barnard, my mind automatically goes back to our commencement speaker. Did anybody else graduate in 98? No. Okay, so our commencement speaker basically got up. We were these like bright-eyed, you know, eager students graduating Barnard College, and she said, "You can't have it all." And I remember just feeling like, what is going on? But she was referring to, you know, an executive level career within a big media outlet and saying that you can't sort of compare how far women can get with men if they're like raising families and doing all these other things. And so something I've been thinking a lot about lately because I have a 4 and a 2-year-old is that my work is very conducive to this family life balance. And that's been really important to me. And so, you know, it hasn't sort of come always obviously, but I've had to sort of know what I want and ask for it and pursue it. And having that vision and pursuing it, I think, is really important for all of us to keep in mind, too.
So our final speaker in the session will be Jamie Consuega. Oh, right, and you don't have any.
I don't have slides.
You don't have slides, so we'll just. Oops. What am I doing? I'm going the wrong way. I'm showing everybody else's slides. Sorry about that. There we go. So we'll have you in front of a nice picture.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for having me today. It's really great to be back on campus. So as Stephanie mentioned, I'm the Legislative Director for the Climate and Clean Air Program at NRDC. NRDC was founded in 1970 by a small group of litigators. We've grown some over the past 47 years, and we're now we now have a staff of over 500 lawyers, scientists, and advocates. Our mission is to safeguard the earth It's people, it's plants and animals, and the natural systems on which all life depends. And our relatively new president, Rhea Sue, is also a proud Barnard alum. And before I talk a little bit about what I'm doing now, I thought it might be helpful to talk about how I got here. When I came to Barnard, I knew I probably wanted to study environmental issues, and then I took Professor Bauer's intro to environmental science, and I never looked back. I spent a semester at the biosphere and just completely fell in love with fieldwork, and I begged Martin to let me study abroad as much as he would possibly let me. And then the summer before my senior year, I ended up working with a scientist in Costa Rica looking at the relationship between amphibian declines, a deadly fungus, and climate change. And he invited me to be a part of his project, and we published the results in Nature. And at that point, I was on track to get a degree in environmental science. And following the publication of the paper, there was sort of a media splash, but it was very short-lived. And I should say that the scientist had been working on this project for decades. He'd been sort of posted out in the cloud forest in Monteverde, just hunkering down, analyzing data. Martin's data analysis class definitely came in handy for that one. And so I was just outraged that we had published these results and there was no policy action to match what I felt like were, you know, scientists ringing these alarm bells on the need to take climate action. So that's when I decided that I wanted to go into environmental policy, but there were a couple problems. I had never studied environmental policy and didn't really know what I was doing. So I figured I would start with environmental nonprofits, and I applied to every job that I was remotely qualified for, and ended up as a climate research assistant at the Natural Resources Defense Council in 2007. And about a year later, President Obama was elected, and the stars started to align for legislative climate action. So it was a really exciting time to be in DC. Democrats controlled both the House and the Senate, and there was an appetite in the appropriate congressional committees. And around the same time, I was promoted to a legislative advocate, and I spent my time sort of marching around the halls of Congress and meeting with stakeholders and legislators and their staff, tracking vote counts and analyzing legislative text. And not long after, Congressman Waxman and Markey drafted a promising piece of legislation that put a cap on greenhouse gases. And it successfully cleared the House and then stalled out in the Senate. And as the 111th Congress was drawing to a close, President Obama had a choice to make. He could push really hard for legislative action on climate or healthcare. And he chose healthcare, and that's how we ended up with Obamacare. And that was just before the 2010 election when there was the Tea Party wave and Democrats lost control of the House, and with it, our ability to legislate on climate change. But there were administrative tools available to cut carbon pollution from some of the largest sources, including the power sector. So my team at NRDC got straight to work thinking through creative policy options. So the Clean Air Act was passed in 1970, but is sort of this really intuitive law that is meant to address modern challenges identified by scientists. So there's actually a means by which the administration can issue rules to cap carbon pollution from, say, the power sector, from coal-fired power plants, or from the oil and gas sector, or from vehicles. And so that's the pathway that Obama pursued. It didn't sit well with a number of Republicans in Congress, so during that time, after the rule was initially proposed and finally promulgated, there were tons of legislative attacks to gut the Clean Air Act and undo the Clean Power Plan. But with a 60-vote threshold in the Senate, we were able to maintain the line, and the Clean Air Act still stands. And then Trump was elected, and everything changed in D.C. He installed an industry-friendly climate denier to run the Environmental Protection Agency. And in March, he issued an executive order that will start to unwind most of President Obama's climate and energy policies. And not long after that, he announced that he was going to be withdrawing us from the Global Climate Accord, the Paris deal that was reached 2 years ago. And a few weeks ago, Administrator Pruitt announced his intention to repeal the Clean Power Plan through a new rulemaking. And then on top of all these massive policy changes, the administration is simultaneously trying to starve the budgets of agencies that work on protecting public health from environmental harm. So they want to slash EPA's budget by 30%, which I don't think is going to happen because Congress also has a say, but there's no question that these agencies have already been underfunded for decades. So the past 11 months have been really professionally challenging, but I think there are also reasons for hope. Cities and states are stepping up like never before, and they're committing to keeping their Paris agreements. There was a rally in front of the Capitol this morning. A bunch of congressmen and senators were out there with the "I'm still in" hashtag. I encourage you all to take part. And I think a handful of Republicans in the House especially are sort of starting to see the writing on the wall. They can't be the party of no and no climate action forever because constituents are starting to take notice. And finally, the clean energy economy is here. Trump is promising to bring back coal, but that's just not the direction that our country has been headed for the last 8 years. So, you know, I think we'll continue to see a growth in clean energy. And then I'll just wrap by saying that there are tons of opportunities for engagement in federal policy, and we're going to have a lot of ground to make up come 2020 or when we next have a pro-climate president. And so look forward to answering questions and meeting with folks during the break that may be interested in pursuing federal climate policy, because we could use the help in D.C. So, thank you.
Thanks to all of you. That was really terrific. I'll start off with one question for everyone. We'll just go down the row in this order. And then everybody start thinking of questions that you would like to ask them. They're here to address your questions and concerns. So my question is, many of you mentioned a course or some kind of academic experience that you had that was really pivotal, that kind of shifted you in one direction to make where you wanted to make positive change. And I'm just wondering, looking ahead and seeing the environmental issues that are facing us today and the societal issues, what kind of courses or academic programming or extracurricular programming would you recommend that we consider in our department, maybe adding or fostering or developing? Let's start with Commissioner Trautenberg.
Well, I mean, I'll tie in the theme here that's come up a little bit, sort of how you take the scientific end of it and translate it into policy and political action at the national or the local or the state level. I've had some of the same experiences Jamie had. I fought many lonely environmental battles in my time. I was on Capitol Hill for many, many years, and I have to say, when it came to the environmental battles, lost far more often than we won, unfortunately. And it is unbelievably crucial, although very, very hard, and someone had, I don't know, a chart up there that had a couple bubbles that didn't quite connect. It's extremely important that those that are on the scientific and the research end can help translate and connect their work to what policymakers and advocates and practitioners on the ground, like I am now at a city agency, do. So courses that help you do that, they're interdisciplinary, and as someone up there, I think you had said, it's hard, but it's very, very crucial.
I ultimately learned policy by doing it, and actually before coming over today, I went to what was Labyrinth just to sort of check out their environmental policy section, and most of the books are from 2010 or earlier, and you know, so much has happened in the last 7 years, so I think it's also helpful to sort of have practitioners talking to students too, and you know, we're sort of making it up as we go along, and so having that exchange with students sort of in real time, I think, could be valuable.
Thanks. Jessica.
I don't know if there's a class like this here, but I took a class in my for my PhD program called Climate and Society, which basically you know, looked at, I think, a lot of what we're talking about. So I don't know if there's one, but something along those lines. But then also I would second the, you know, engaging practitioners, bringing them in and having, you know, encouraging students to do projects that aren't only, you know, I guess traditionally scientific, but that are social science, getting them out and working with the communities, which I know you do already, but.
So actually to do this, we created a major at my previous university in environmental studies, and I remember exchanging emails with Peter and Joe. I was like, what do? I need to make this curriculum from scratch. So I've thought a lot about this, and my experience here showed me that it's the connections between the things where you really start to make progress. It's the connections between the classes or between your experiences. So what we think about now is how to give students a more holistic experience. Because, you know, for a long time we treated each class as a separate experience and students had to make their own connections. But now, I guess, I'm sure they do this here, we do these thematic year. So a whole bunch of the classes you're gonna take that year are on energy, whether it's social science or humanities or science. And so just to try and show the students that everything is really connected. And I think people have gotten better at that. When I was a student, even when I went to a graduate school, I got my PhD from the Nicholas School of the Environment, and it touted its interdisciplinary program, but I have to say, they hadn't figured out yet, this was in the 90s, how to give people that interdisciplinary, both the depth and the breadth. Mm-hmm. So I think people are sorting that out better now.
Terrific, thank you.